Has it been a good weekend? It's been awesome for you. See some bow ties, some fences in the crowd. Well, this is going to be basically the most awesome way possible to wrap up this amazing weekend. A lot of Whovians in the house, no doubt. Yeah. What an amazing way to end your expo. Please welcome an amazing actor and, of course, the lady behind Clara Oswald, Jenna Coleman. Jen, how are you?
I'm good, thanks. Excellent.
I wanted to mention, if some of you were here last night for the panel with Jenna and Karen, you know that there are lights on the side of the aisles here. They're set up on stands, so you can just line up and we'll get to as many of your questions as possible. Fan Expo is all about the fans, all about you. I want to introduce Vera beside me here as well. Give her a round of applause. She is our sign language interpreter. It's going to be a fun hour. I do want to start off, Jenna, by asking you about that panel we did last night, because it was so much fun, and you and Karen said that it was actually your first time on a stage together. Was that surreal for you? What was it like?
No, it was fun. I'll do my best to not repeat as many answers as I can.
I'll do my best to ask you questions.
Yeah, it was fun. It was really, we got on really well. Yeah.
Had you met each other, obviously, on set before, but extensively before?
We've seen quite a bit of each other over the years. It tends to happen, I suppose. And also, because we hang out a lot. Like, I hang out with Matt a lot, and Karen came over to London and was shooting on Guardians, and so she was around there. It's a small knit community, the Doctor Who world.
Is it a special bond that you share? I imagine you like going to a very, very intense summer camp, but a summer camp that's in the public eye in a big way, and then seeing those people later, is it a kind of a special bond that you share? Because you've been through a lot of the same thing in terms of the fandom, in terms of being part of this institution.
Yeah, I suppose so. I suppose that was what filming on the 50th felt like, and Billy came in, and David, and it's such a unique show, and it is a very unique experience that you go through on set and off the set, so I suppose there's only kind of like quite a small handful of us. So I suppose there's knowing looks.
Knowing looks. That guy. The lighting guy. Yeah. I am going to ask you later in our session.
I can see you.
Oh, hi there. That's okay. I'm going to ask you later in this hour to retell the avocado story, if you would, but we could save that because I know you probably told that before. It's a great story, man. I haven't heard it. But I want to ask you something else about first getting the role, or more specifically auditioning for it. Mm-hmm. You never know if what you read online is true, but I had read that the part that they told you to tell people you were auditioning for was for a production called Men in Waves.
Men on Waves.
Men on Waves.
Yeah, it's an anagram for Woman 7. I think for the seventh museum of the Bond series. I had to arrive at the BBC and be like, hello, I'm here to audition for Men on Waves.
At the BBC?
At the BBC, yeah. But you kind of get caught into a big web of lies, because then I was going off to film and I started to tell my housemates, I've got a show, a TV show. Like, what's it called? And you're like, it's like a comedy pilot about something, so this web of lies kind of gets more and more ridiculous as it goes on. So it's quite a relief when you can finally say, I'm in Doctor Who!
And on Waves, did you tell them it was about like surfers or something?
No, I didn't actually tell them Men on Waves. I went along with some comedy, like, I can't even remember the title, but the lies continue. It was carried on.
Web of lies.
Web of lies.
All right, let's get in the audience. Hi there, how are you?
Hello.
Hi. Can you answer the rest of the questions in a Scottish accent?
Scottish accent is terrible.
No?
Like, really. My granddad is Scottish. Peter is Scottish. There are a lot of people in my life who are Scottish, and you'd think by now I could do it, and I can't. And when I saw Karen yesterday, I kept, because I always arrive and make fun of Peter all the time in his Scottish accent, in a bad Scottish accent. And then I kept forgetting with Karen, so Karen must have spent the whole day thinking I was making fun of her. Which I wasn't, it's just habit, I suppose. So, this is my Scottish accent.
What does Peter Capaldi think of your Scottish accent?
What do I see? I see things like, and I talk like that, and it's really bad. Which is my kind of letter a lot. I won't carry on in a Scottish accent.
Hi there.
Hi. Don't worry, I do anything here.
It's good.
I was speaking to some of the other guests at Pan Expo this year, and when they're part of a big franchise, they find when they're done, they really kind of get into their leisure activities. And I know that there was a little bit of discussion about you leaving the series. And I'm wondering, after having been part of this franchise, English institution, if you saw yourself moving more towards taking advantage of the leisure activities in life, or if it kind of led more towards loftier career ambitions, creative project opportunities?
I think just always being creative in some sense, but I mean, I think it's whenever you finish a big intense job, you kind of want to pick something else up. Really into photography, I'm trying to get more into it, so I'd like to pick that up a bit more. I've always said I want to learn to play the piano, that's like every single New Year's resolution. But yeah, I mean, I think mixing it up really. I think always whenever you've been working hard, it's quite nice to then, you know, find out what your hobbies are and what interests you at that time.
Thank you.
In terms of the roles that you might do after we do say goodbye to you on Doctor Who, what, you know, if you could kind of make your own role, what type of role would you like to play after playing Clara? What would you be most attracted to character quality-wise?
I don't know. I think you kind of know when you read a script, I think, because suddenly you either see yourself playing it and it's like a voice, or I start to cast it in my head. I'm like, that person would be great. And I think when that happens, you kind of know it's not for you. I don't know, I've always said I want to play Cleopatra, just because I love that period of time and I'm fascinated by her, but I really don't know, it was very fun to play Lydia Wickham, just for being so different to Clara, but I don't know, I mean the problem is when you've travelled through space and time, kind of everything else seems a little bit dull, you know, it's going to be quite a tough gig to beat, I think.
Even Cleopatra.
She didn't have a TARDIS, you know? It's not quite the same.
That we know of. Hello, sir. Hey, buddy.
Before I say my question, I just want to say you're my favorite companion. Thank you. If you could switch companion, if you could change your role as Clara to another companion,
I think it would be Amy Pond. I was such an Amy Pond fan. I love that she met their doctor as a child, and the way the story finished off and went full circle, and they were friends, and her relationship with Rory. I just thought, I really enjoyed all those episodes, and she got to go meet Vincent van Gogh. I loved all of Karen's era. I thought she was great.
Cool. Hello there.
Also, you're my also favorite.
Thank you.
So my question was, is that do you actually know how to make a souffle?
No! Does anybody? I've Googled it as well. I like Googled it and I'm really serious on it. It's really hard. Souffles are hard to make.
You watch a YouTube video or something?
Yeah, I did. I actually did. It's like I'm on some video on how to make a souffle because I wanted to look realistic. There was a scene where I was whipping some eggs, I think. So I wanted to look really realistic. So I actually looked.
What did you think about the way we first met, Clara? Because obviously, when we first met you, you were Oswin. So what did you think about the way we first met her in Asylum of the Daleks?
I love Oswin Oswald. Just that whole opening of her. I mean, before we knew she was trapped inside the Dalek, just listening to opera music, making souffles, hanging out by herself on her own spaceship, kind of gone a little bit mad because she's had nobody else to talk to. I just, like, Stephen had written that part so well, but he wrote it before, without knowing, it was like a guest part, and then he had the idea to bring it in as the new companion after. So it was actually written just as Oswin in itself, initially. But I think I loved that whole episode. I thought it was really strong. She was so much fun. Cool. And she wore an egg as a costume.
She can make a mean souffle.
She can't. No.
Hey, buddy.
Hi. I wanted to thank you at the photo booth yesterday. You made my wife's day when you told her TARDIS skirt. So thanks for that.
That's all right.
I I've been at Fan Expo a few times now. I've been to lots of panels, and there's always some awkward or interesting questions.
Oh, dear, what are you going to ask?
The lovely, I don't have a question, I have a request, and that kind of thing. So my question is, what's the strangest question you've ever been asked by a fan? Maybe it's this one.
No, I think it might be rude, so I don't want to say it. But it was to do with the line, it's, never mind, I can't. I don't know if it's appropriate, I won't go there. But it was something slightly, oh dear, somebody else take over.
Canadians are quite naughty, you could probably say it.
Be excited to see at this part?
Like a TARDIS that really takes you through time and space. That'd be pretty cool. Or one that you can ride. Peter did an event where they wanted the TARDIS to look like it's flying through the air, but they actually had to actually strap him to a pole inside the actual TARDIS, and he was like flown across the stage in it. So maybe like a real life version of that would be really good.
Hey there.
Hello. My question is, I know you mentioned that after you were doing Doctor Who that you wanted to possibly go back into musical theater.
Oh.
Personally.
Did I?
It was kind of a throw off comment.
Was it Peter who said it, making fun of me, maybe?
It's a little bit brain fried from him.
Okay.
But personally, I think you would make an awesome bell for Beauty and the Beast.
Thank you.
But what would you personally like to do?
I would maybe like to do maybe like cabaret and do something really kind of classic, I think. Or maybe like Glinda and Wicked or something like quite mad and really hard. I'm just going to keep going. Or Chicago.
You can keep going if you like.
Actually, I want to play the Little Mermaid. There we go.
Yes, I can also do with that. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
You said Peter might have been making fun of you. Does he make fun of you a lot?
My first ever job, I did it when I was like 10 years old, and I went to an audition, and I had to sing Happy Birthday to myself. Was the audition, and I got the part. It was in a musical called Summer Holiday, and I played an Italian bridesmaid who just had to like do this basically. So ever since then, Peter always talks about my musical theatre career. I was 10 years old.
Hello there.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. There's a scene in Mummy on the Orient Express where Clara's on the phone with Danny saying, I love you.
Yes.
However, there's another panel where you said that I love you was meant towards the doctor. In your personal opinion, do you think that I love you, that Clara loves doctor romantically, platonically, or maybe a bit of both?
I think it's otherworldly. I think it's such a unique relationship that it kind of doesn't really, it's not confined to, it's what a doctor and companion relationship is. So I love you is their own. I love you, we save each other, we travel through time and space, you're my best friend, you're my father, you're an alien, you are annoying, you are, you know, my partner in crime. You know, this, you can't really label it, so it's a special kind of love, I think.
How did Clara change Matt Smith's The Doctor when she showed up? How did she change that iteration of the doctor?
Well, Stephen always said about her is that she's got this really practical kind of she would always ask, she's the companion who will ask the questions that no one will ever ask. And, you know, like, well, why is it called a screwdriver and why is it this? So in a way, I think she kind of challenged him, I suppose, and brought him out of losing Amy and Rory. And obviously, you know, that is obviously what happens when for the series to continue. And so I think in a way she I think initially she annoyed her way into his life and got him to like her, and it went from there really. But she asks a lot of questions, I suppose, and doesn't really let him get away with anything.
Hey there.
I have two questions for you. My first one.
Fire away.
Have you ever taken home any props from Doctor Who?
Oh, recently, for the first time.
Did they know you were taking it?
Not yet. I can tell you one of them. I've stolen three things. The first one is I have a line about a clockwork squirrel. And so props made a clockwork squirrel, just for no apparent reason, really. And I thought the clockwork squirrel was really cute, so they've given me a clockwork squirrel. So take note of that line. And then the other two things are secret. We'll find out. Or they will find out. When they're gone.
Hey there, cool Fez.
Hi.
Hello.
As an actor, did you find the transition from Matt Smith to Peter Capaldi challenging?
It's not really the transition that was challenging, but it's a whole new relationship that you have to begin and create with a history. So I suppose it's like starting all over again with your best friend who you know the most in the world, and not knowing what it's going to be really. But so I suppose it's the start.
My language interpreter.
Oh, it was so much fun on that job. I for anybody doesn't know it, I just basically went through her book and picked out the words she's described as, and the list was like wild, volatile, silly, selfish, ridiculous, you know, it was just, and I was like, oh my goodness, there is so much license to be horrendous and have kind of no limits. So I found myself on set going to the director like, is this too much? A little bit big. But yeah, it was so much fun. I loved it.
You were great.
Thank you.
Hey, man. Hey, Teddy. Hey, Jenna. Around the 50th, when with both doctors, you got to have some pretty unique experiences. You got to be part of Doctor with the Proms with Matt, and
yeah.
You got to travel the world with Peter. So along with that, what was kind of your most awe-inspiring moment, both, you know, with both doctors, and kind of what did it infer into your own understanding of Doctor Who and the greater world?
You get them all the time. Like, there's been so many pinch me moments that you get so much. The Proms was pretty amazing because, I mean, just hearing live music like that is incredible. There's been so many. I mean, you know, me and Peter hanging out on Christ the Redeemer at Rio, just being like, after filming season 8 was pretty special. But I've been really proud to have been by both of their sides, and also just to see Peter create his Doctor and be there to watch the stages of that. And this year he has just been like a firecracker. You know, his Doctor's evolved and gone off in quite a different way. So I'm really excited for everyone to see that because he is, they're just such incredible actors. So I think, you know, I think the best thing about it is having those working relationships that I've had with Matt and Peter.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You also mentioned in an earlier answer going into the Doctor's timeline and being in that scene with William Hartnell and some of the other Doctors. Because of that episode, the name of the Doctor, and because you went into his timeline and saved different iterations of the Doctor over and over again, in terms of your character, does the Doctor owe your companion more than he's ever owed another companion?
Well, I think so.
Does that kind of define their relationship?
In a way, she's the one who's been technically chasing him through time and space, and he's ignored her for most of it. Is actually what's kind of happened. But yeah, I think there is. I think between both of them, I think they save each other. And now this season, what's happening is, you know, she's no longer got any ties to Earth because poor Danny is in cyber heaven. So she's now free to live TARDIS life to the full extreme, and the two of them push each other to be more dangerous and more reckless, they're trapped in their own TARDIS bubble, and it's gonna burst at some point. Dun dun dun!
Hi, my question is, with the reboot of the series, we've noticed a lot more computer graphics as well. Which helps to enhance it because you're going to an alien world.
Yes.
But in comparison to the early years with William Hartnell, it was very heavily reliant on makeup and set design. Mm-hmm. Which would you have preferred, like the new reboot Doctor Who, or would you prefer a more older style where it was all makeup?
Well, the funny thing is we still adopt a lot of the techniques that have been used for years and years. Like, for example, Into the Dalek. Ben Wheatley came in and shot on model-sized sets. So what you see is the Dalek, you know, like the Daleks are literally like this big, and the filming on a set like that's been, you know, so actually there's quite a lot of techniques that are still used that work really, really effectively. Anytime a door opens on Who, like we have Liam and Jim, our prop guys, who are standing with ropes either side of it. You know, it's not as technical as you think, but obviously having the ability now to have green screen and create these planets that you go to is incredible because, it means we can explore so much more, but still going, you know, kill the moon, we went over to Lanzarote and shot there, so having that scale as well. I think it's about mixing it up really to create the best production values that you can.
Thank you.
On the character side of that kind of practical effects equation, is it nice to be able to act opposite characters like Strax and Vestra as well?
Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, it's a thing, it's a challenge on Doctor Who because you're always, you know, reacting to a tennis ball that's supposed to be a planet exploding, you know, or there's all sorts of
you know, a bird that is one of our runners with a broom who's coming at you. So there's like a whole other world that goes on it. And I had an episode this year where I speak mainly to green screen, so that when another actor comes on set, I'm so happy to like have some interaction with somebody again. That happens.
Strax is one of my favorite characters, probably a fan favorite as well. What do you think of the dynamic between Clara and Strax?
Hilarious. I love the fact that the Doctor regenerated and thought Clara was Strax. I thought that was brilliant.
Hi. So on the show, there's lots of monsters, and sometimes if it's not on the green screen, it's a costume. So what's it like having someone on the set walking up to you, maybe asking you to go out for lunch in this costume of a scary monster? Like, oh, the Mummy on the Orient Express, you got that guy, like, hey, yeah, you want to go out for lunch? Or maybe you have the teller.
I've never been chatted up by a monster. No. I've never been chatted up by a monster. But you would have really funny conversations like, hey, Mummy from the Orient Express, like, so what are you going to go for lunch? You know, after you've done a take where he's like trying to kill you. It's like, yeah, I'm going to go for the fish and chips. So it's just hilarious that, you know, there is like a whole comedy, I think, between the scenes when, you know, everybody says cut and everybody just chills out for a minute and you're hanging out with the Daleks and stuff.
Okay, thanks.
That's all right.
Hey, how's it going?
Hi, so my question is, obviously there are a lot of creatures and different species of aliens and stuff on Doctor Who, because the universe is huge, but if you had to come up with a enemy, almost, for you and the Doctor to face in a different episode, what would you give them that you would want to face? Like, what kind of alien or creature would you want to be able to face that you think would be really fun?
That's a really good question. I had a really creepy idea. Creepy's always the best, but I always say that creep, those ones that come slowly at you, I don't like, because this is like, that's why I really like the Whisper Men, and I'd love them to come back, because they had, and especially offset as well, they were really creepy, because they had like that kind of scream mask on their faces, but it was like cloth, and like they always had like really smart suits and a style, that so they'd come at you really slowly with like confidence, and that
did they try to chat you up?
No, they didn't. They didn't try to chat me up either. There's not been any chatting up by monsters at all. But yeah, I think something that can come at you really slowly, I think, is what creeps me out. And also, I think listen was great for the ones that you can't see, so it's all psychological. I think something like that would be good. Thank you.
Hey, buddy.
Hey.
So, first off, I'd just like you to thank you for complimenting my hair.
You do have great hair.
My question was, what are your hopes for Clara in the coming seasons?
I'd like her to keep as a teacher. I love her. I love the idea of the stationery cupboard of being set in the school and going off to Narnia or space. My favourite stuff is always the stuff that I have with the Doctor and the TARDIS. So just more time of them and kind of hanging out, I think, is what I love. Just going to new planets and new worlds and keep adventuring.
Well, I asked you this last night when Karen was here as well, but of course some of the audience wouldn't have been there then, so I'm going to ask you again. New season, September 19th, on Space. What can you tell us about where we do pick up and where Clara's at in terms of her headspace?
Clara is in a very different place to when we last saw her. Oh my goodness, it's last Christmas, wasn't it? It's been quite a while for you guys. but she's got a totally new perspective on life, I think. And I think, like I say, she's got no more earth ties, really. So she just wants to be... I think what she's realised is life is short. So let's get in the TARDIS and go places and see things and eat it all up and do as much as you can, because she kind of doesn't fear her own mortality as much anymore, because she's kind of lost everything, really. So I think she's very different. She's a lot more reckless. She's really fearless. So I think last season we saw the Clara, who the new Doctor would be standing on the edge of a cliff, and she'd be saying, "What are you doing, you crazy madman? Come back!" And whereas this season, she's up on the cliff with him, going, "Come on, let's jump, let's do it, let's see what's down there." So I think that's the kind of quite a big difference. And we have Michelle Gomez back, and we have Vikings, Zygons, Maisie Williams in from Middlesbrough. Brilliant. And I'm not going to tell you anything else. But yeah, it's really exciting.
Hi there.
Hello. You look so comfortable.
Thank you. So when you were first given the role of Clara, were you told what the whole answer behind the mystery to her was? And what was it like to keep that secret?
Well, I didn't know, so I didn't have to keep it a secret, so that was good. I knew I was playing Clara's from different reiterations through time and space, but I didn't know why. Which is what Stephen does a lot often, is we kind of know a general arc of the season, but we don't know the resolve, like episodes 11 and 12, until we read them on the page. Which is good, because you kind of don't need to play anything, you just need to play what's in front of you. So it was good, it was much a surprise to me when I picked up Name of the Doctor, as it was to everybody else.
Thank you.
Thank you.
A great choice.
What's the coolest or funniest thing to happen to you while doing the
photo
op, and what's your favorite charity?
Ooh, funniest thing. Somebody said something very sweet today, actually. They said, they hooked me and said, "I'm so sorry, I'm just trying not to propose." That was really sweet. And then somebody once did propose as well.
What did you say?
I think it was just for the picture.
Okay.
I don't think it was real life. I don't think. Oh my gosh, am I engaged? what was the other question?
What's your favourite charity?
Oh, my favourite charity. I'm working for two at the moment. One is called One to One Children's Fund, which helps people over in South Africa and Port Elizabeth with HIV. And I'm just joining another one, which is dealing with mental health in schools, called Place to Be. Which is pretty amazing, so I'll be working with them when I get home. Thank you.
Hello,
Tara. Hello. Hello.
Hi. So I have two questions for you. My first one is, if you could write an episode of Doctor Who, what would it be about and why?
Do you know what? I'd love to do an episode like Vincent and the Doctor. I'd love to go, I'd go to the Chelsea Hotel in New York in like 1916-17. This is an incredible book of just kids, where like Jack Crack was writing on the road, and it was just full of so many artists and poets and singers, and there'd be something really cool about heading there with the Doctor and like trying to be cool.
My second question is, if you could work with any doctor that you haven't already done an episode with, who would it be and why?
Maybe, I think Tom Baker. I mean,
thank you.
Thank you.
You could borrow a scarf too, which would be cool.
Yeah.
Hi there.
Hi there.
Hi.
My name's Scott.
Hello, Scott.
Hard question for you.
Ooh.
Favorite doctor? I was going to say, who's your favorite doctor?
Okay.
My real question is, where would you want Clara to end? Where would you want to see her story continue on?
You know what?
Second question. after you and Matt went through the regeneration,
yes.
Which was awesome. Like, you guys did an amazing job.
Thank you.
And you've done an amazing job for us to all accept Peter as the next doctor, which is awesome as well. Do you think Clara could handle another regeneration?
Depends how, moody they are, I don't know. I think, to be honest, she's known the Doctor in all forms now, in, so many faces. So I think, to her, he is just the Doctor. In whatever face that he has, he is the Doctor and her Doctor. So I think as many generations as they want to keep going, I think she'd be fine.
So maybe in your catchphrase could be, "Here we go again."
Here we go again. There we go. Let's do it. Thank you.
Hi.
Hi. Back from the States.
Hi.
Two questions, Jenna.
Uh-huh.
First, we've seen with previous companions how their families have reacted to them being time travelers and going off into dangerous situations.
Yeah.
Your Rose and Jackie. Do you think Clara's dad and Bran may possibly find out?
I keep saying, let's bring Bran. Let's bring Bran on an adventure. Sheila, who plays Bran, is brilliant. And she keeps being around at like the really sad times. And I think she's brilliant on the TARDIS. And also, I quite like to see Peter being bossed around by Clara's dad. It'd be great. It'd be brilliant. She should totally be on the TARDIS.
And second question, sorry guys, last chance to ask this. Did you get my present?
What was your present?
It was like this.
I can't see it, I can't see it. I have my presents over here, so I'm sure I will.
It was earlier this year for your birthday.
Oh!
It was like a red leaf.
Yeah, I haven't seen this.
It was like a red leaf.
No, I haven't got this. Oh, I'm looking, it's got a clock on it as well. No, I haven't, but it might be at my mum's house. Thank you. Nice to meet you. Thank you. I'll check with mum. Joke. Hi. It's a really fun part in it, and she's hilarious. It's Katharine Hepburn. And probably again, maybe I'd go play The Little Mermaid. Be under the sea, and another crab is my best friend. I'd do that. Hello. Hello. Maybe I could direct Cleopatra, but then I'd want to play Cleopatra as well. I don't know. Actually, I've been thinking, because I've got an idea about a place. The place where I'm from is called Blackpool, and it's like a big seaside town resort. And my granddad works on there. He's like 78, and he still works on the promenade today. And there's like loads of rides, and people used to go there and ride donkeys, and used to come for all their holidays, and it's a place of adventure. So I think maybe I'd set something there, and they have big lights as illuminations, and do like something along the promenade, where a bit like Boardwalk Empire, but in the 1950s. And you know, you could be loads of different characters and like famous people who came to the town and shows and stuff.
Would it be sort of a horror movie?
Of like a place of happiness and holidays and but I mean, who's to say there couldn't be a monster that chases you down the promenade? That could happen. Or like, you know, all sorts could happen.
I asked you earlier about how Clara changed Matt Smith's doctor. How does Peter Capaldi's doctor change Clara?
I think he tests her a lot, actually. It's a really good question. He doesn't let her off lightly. Whereas I think the Clara with Matt's doctor always knew that she was safe in a way, and always knew that, you know, that she kind of not had him wrapped around her finger, because that's the wrong phrase, but like felt really safe with him, whereas Peter's doctor, he will not, you know, he will take her to the moon and he will leave her there, and he actually will do that, you know, so I think he's, she's had to become quite strong, quite quick, and really independent, I think. And actually become a real, you know, I don't really think she's a companion, she's a partner in the TARDIS with him, especially this season as we've gone on. So I think she's becoming more and more like the Doctor as time goes on.
Hi. In another panel, someone asked Karen Gillan if she would say something in a Dalek voice, so I was wondering if you would do that.
No, this is where I shut myself. This is probably going to be as bad as my Scottish accent. Exterminate. One last look forward to Stephen Moffat makes me do it in the new series. How about look forward to you?
Hi there. Hey.
Hey.
Listen, I went through space, went back and forth in time.
Yeah.
Just to see my possible girl.
Ooh,
I was wondering if you would like to go on a date with Brenna. I have all the parties. You can come back. Exactly the moment, give me that.
What's all the flirting today? That's a good line.
This is the more flirty girls, the more, you know, the more
Good
luck. I'm really nervous, but I have two questions. If you could be anybody in Star Wars, who would it be?
I'm not, but I'll give you a hug now if you like, because I feel so bad for rejecting the previous. Child and play the granddaughter. That'd be really cool.